You wanted it, and by God, now you've got it. This video was inevitable and you've requested it for a long time now, and finally I do think the time is right to tell the US Gold story. They're a publisher with, well, not exactly a good reputation. Despite the initial aim of the company to bring the best in American games over to British computers, well, in most people's eyes a lot of them aren't great, to say the least. Americans who may say wanly that Ocean represented the crap side of British games development have obviously never played any US Gold title. But they are a very important games company indeed, one of the biggest of the 80s and 90s in Europe, and well, their releases weren't all bad, far from it. There's lots of fun things to go through. So, let's get on with it. At various times I've described games companies as being rock and roll, mainly thanks to their flashy lifestyle or how they burnt out so fast, imagine being the prime example of course. But Jeff Brown, the eventual boss of US Gold? Well, he actually lived it, if only for a brief time. If not for other events, there's a chance US Gold may have never existed at all, because in the 1970s, Jeff Brown was in a band called Muscles, a proper blue-eyed British soul funk outfit. Here's the pictures, curly hair, opened up shirts, none more 70s. And there's Jeff Brown, right there, principal songwriter. Now yeah, you might say, surely there's plenty of folks in games who had shitty failed bands beforehand. Well, this went further. Jeff had been playing music professionally, achieving a degree of success in the Midlands, since the 1960s. But in 1977, Muscles were on the verge of stardom. The band were a staple on the Midlands live scene, a solid, tight group that was generating buzz throughout the region. And after several singles and an album that had bubbled under the charts, in the middle of 1977 they would record their mega hit, their most famous song, If It Relaxes Your Mind. If you listen to it, yeah, it sounds like a hit, a proper bouncy funk song, kind of level 42-ish only a few years earlier, with a melody that immediately latches onto your brain, the sort of song that, being a bass player, I thoroughly appreciate. It was surely to be, at the very least, a top 10 single. BBC Radio 1 added it to their playlist and went so far as to name it their record of the week. As the song continued to climb up the charts, Muscles were scheduled for what would surely be their big breakthrough moment, a performance on the biggest chart show in the country, Top of the Pops. If you're performing on TOTP, well, in almost every case it's a guaranteed hit. Top 20, top 10, top 5, maybe even number 1. And from there, who knows? This was it, the big moment, the one that hundreds of thousands of bands dream of. On August the 18th, 1977, Muscles were to record their Top of the Pops performance. With one fobbed-off intro from Jimmy Savile and a horde of screaming girls in front of them, their lives would be forever changed. Or not. Because of what happened on August the 16th, Elvis Presley died at the age of 42. With the death of Elvis, everything fell into absolute chaos, including the charts. Suddenly, everything about that week's Top of the Pops had to change. Everything about the charts had to change. This seismic event, the death of the biggest star in the world, had to be acknowledged, in full. And so, Muscle's scheduled appearance on Top of the Pops was cancelled. In the days following the death of the Kin, virtually every Elvis single was reissued, the grief of a nation portrayed via the flooding of the higher and lower reaches of the charts, with Way Down, released a couple of weeks before his death, crashing into the top of the charts by the end of the month. If It Relaxes Your Mind, well, it disappeared from the Radio 1 playlist, never making it into the top 50, and Muscles would never get close to stardom again. It was back to the local grind. But when you've almost tasted the fruit and then had it snatched away from you, it's hard to keep going. Muscles would break up not long thereafter. Just like that, the dream was over. This is just the way that the world works. If Elvis Presley hadn't died, there may well have never been a US Gold to speak of. No one would have ever ended up buying World Cup Carnival. So how do we get from this brush with glory to US Gold? Well, not long after this, Jeff virtually gave up on music as a profession. Instead, he decided to become a maths teacher. Like many, he was curious about all of these home computers that were suddenly appearing on the market, and he soon found himself buying an Atari 800. Using his skills, he was able to learn how to program on it, and actually made a couple of simple educational games, which he tested on his pupils and then sold to a man named Phil Morris, who published them. But of course, Jeff Brown's future did not lay in game development. This is a game called Galactic Chase, a simple yet effective Galaxian clone made in America for the Atari 800 that's also notable for being the first game that Jeff Brown would distribute. Having seen it written up in an Atari magazine, he was curious and sent off for a copy. He thought it was fantastic, and it gave him a bit of an idea. He then showed the game to a buyer at Curry's, who agreed that it was excellent. Jeff said to the buyer that he was the distributor for this game in the UK, and he was testing out the waters with it. Of course he wasn't, at least not yet. The man at Curry's ends up agreeing to 20 copies in the local outlet. Jeff learns it all as he goes along. He phones up Spectrum Computers in America, the publishers of the game, they work out a contract, he gets the 20 copies, sells them to Curry's, they fly off the shelf, Jeff pays the Americans within the 30 days and makes a profit. And just like that, Jeff Brown was a games distributor. This was his first, and it certainly would not be his last. Of course, Jeff was not alone. There were two people behind what would become U.S. Gold, one being Jeff and the other being his wife, Anne Brown. Jeff was the natural salesman, though a novice, he was quick to learn the ropes. Anne was the business mind who actually set all this up as a proper business, starting under the name of Soft Sell. Still, the principle of what was to become U.S. Gold was set up right here in the very beginning, to take the best games from America and distribute them here in the UK. The deals with Curry's in particular would continue, and eventually Jeff's garage was pretty much full of software, so they needed an actual building, and then a building becomes an office becomes a warehouse, and so eventually Soft Sell became CenterSoft. Gradually, copies of games were coming in by the pallet load, hundreds, thousands. It was still a big learning process, and the new company were living very much on their wits, but it was working. Enough for extensions of credit and for the business to improve further. Still, CenterSoft, while becoming a bigger and bigger company, was very much a background player. It wasn't a big brand or anything. And it was thought that in order for these imported games to really sell, that was what was going to be needed. It's better to actually get the data and duplicate the cassettes or discs yourself rather than ordering it all in from America after all. In 1984, that would all change with the formation of US Gold itself. Now, the way that US Gold works is actually sort of odd, something in the middle between distributor and publisher. They're actually more akin to a record label. That was the general idea. If you look at any old US Gold game, all the labels of the company that originally made and published the game are all still there, but US Gold are now no longer reliant on ordering stock in. They duplicate the data, perhaps add in a little coding just for a logo splash, and now they could take a more forceful role in selling this software, creating the UK's biggest software club, with a reputation for all-American software. And contrary to their later reputation for lousy games, the first games that they sold over here? Bloody fantastic. The triple threat of American games that constituted US Gold's first wave of hits are all stone cold classics: Aztec Challenge, Forbidden Forest, and frickin' Beach-Head. Beach-Head, in particular, is one of the biggest selling games for the C64 over here. Originally made by Access in 1983, the multiple forms of gameplay, the graphics, well, they were just far beyond almost anything that was homegrown on the system at the time. A phenomenal effort that's still pretty fun to play now. The other titles are pretty damn good too, but Beach-Head was the early flagship title for US Gold. It's one of the great early C64 titles, one that really helped to show off what the computer could do when it came to games. And there would soon be more. Much more. Seriously, if you look at the games that US Gold got released over here in the first couple of years, it's classic after classic. Allow for a brief interlude while I show you some of them. Thank you.
Destroy him, my robot.
Ugh, just so many good games. So definitely a lot of credit goes to US Gold for bringing these games over here so that everybody could enjoy them, not to mention giving them all a snazzy box art and so forth that they would occasionally lack when released in the States. Of course, seeing as they aren't distributors, it doesn't make sense to go fully into them as games, although there are certainly a few examples that we'll pick up from in these early times. US Gold's philosophy was to buy tons of games, pretty much, and to let the market decide what was rubbish and what was a hit. And also, there's the certain matter of an alliance with another fast-rising British software house. At this time, Jeff and Dan were still working on little resources and overdrafts. In order to keep things going, they needed a lot more. They needed stability. This would come in the form of Ocean Software. David Ward and John Woods gave them the advance they required for that stability, and in return for that, Ward and Woods took 50% of the company. What, did you think that US Gold and Ocean were rivals? Well, truthfully, I did too at one point. Fierce rivals, I always thought that. But no, US Gold and Ocean were an alliance, with Ward and Woods being part owners. It was, at this time, a mutually beneficial agreement. Who did US Gold work with then? I mean, geez, a lot of people. Epix, Access and Cosmi were amongst the companies working with them at this stage. The first two in particular would bear a lot of fruit thanks to Epix's Games series and Access's Leaderboard series. They also worked with Origin, bringing Ultimas 3 and 4 to the UK. Microprose were on the list, resulting in the likes of F-15 Strike Eagle and Kennedy Approach flying to the UK. Working with SSI would eventually bring in the D&D RPGs like Heroes of the Lance and Pool of Radiance. On the arcade side, US Gold established successful relationships with the likes of Sega and Atari, the former one in particular would last for the whole of their existence. Eventually, US Gold would sign a highly lucrative deal with LucasArts that would see them publish the likes of Indiana Jones and the Fate of Atlantis and The Secret of Monkey Island in the UK. Although that's bringing the timeline forward a bit far. So, back to the mid-80s. There's definitely a couple of games that want extra mention, one being a game that was in a similar vein to Beach-Head and sold with that in mind, but actually goes down as quite a controversial title. 1985's Raid Over Moscow, a game where the aim, quite literally, is to drop a nuke onto the communist capital. It doesn't get much more Cold War than this. The game, probably better known as simply Raid, managed to get the Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament protesting outside of US Gold's doors, which obviously meant that it was a big hit regardless. And with that, the games continued. Many, many games, bought by US Gold, distributed by Centresoft, the company growing ever more popular. US Gold's true rivals, if anyone, were Elite. They were particularly aggrieved when Elite managed to snag the licenses for both Commando and Ghosts and Goblins from under their noses, even more so when both naturally ended up becoming massive hits. This gave US Gold the impetus to switch their focus a little. Instead of computer titles from America, they'd concentrate on coin-op conversions, with Gauntlet in particular being a massive hit. Oh, and of course there was the small matter of one particularly big license. It's so big that frankly it deserves its own chapter. This is perhaps the big reason why I wanted to do a US Gold video, because it means that I can do full coverage of the comical horror that is World Cup Carnival. And before you click away, whether you like footy games or not is utterly irrelevant, this is a story you'll want to hear. It's the one about a rapidly rising British software company very nearly torpedoing their reputation with a game that goes down as one of the stupidest releases in British computing history. So, US Gold managed to snag their first proper license to an event, that being the Mexico 1986 World Cup. Jeff Brown gets the license and gives it to US Gold's manager, Tim Cheney. At this point, especially with U.S. Gold concentrating on arcade conversions, they now have quite a lot of games in the pipeline. Tim Chaney decides that the best thing to do is to work with Ocean on this one, reasoning out that Ocean already had a very successful and good football game, John Whitman's Match Day. A World Cup game using that engine would be fine. Ocean certainly think this to be a good idea. So cool, everything sorted, mate. Nice one. Talk to us when it's done, yeah? Cush tea. Months pass. We're now in around about March of 1986, 3 months before the start of the World Cup, with tons of shit going on still on both sides. Jeff and Tim get together and wonder what's happening with the World Cup game. Jeff calls up Ocean and finds out that Ocean have done nothing. Nothing at all whatsoever. There's no game. Like, whoops. Someone obviously forgot. Having paid for this license, US Gold go into a bit of a tiz at this point. They want something out there desperately, and they send feelers out to virtually every games developer in the UK that they wanted to take a football game, any football game, and make it become their World Cup game. Working with them, overlaying the appropriate branding and such, just get something out. The only company to respond saying they'd be able to do it in the weeks available were Arctic Computing, run by Charles Cecil. Arctic had been successful right at the start of the ZX Spectrum years, producing early text adventures and the like, but the past couple of years had been a struggle for them. Still, they did have a football game, World Cup Football, originally released in 1984. They were somewhat surprised that US Gold wanted to work with them, seeing as it was common knowledge that they were with Ocean and therefore could access Match Day if needed. But still, US Gold did want to work with them, badly. And obviously they weren't going to say that Ocean had put them in the shithouse. With the time that Arctic had, there was virtually nothing that could be done. World Cup Carnival does have tacked-on penalties. It also has a splash screen saying World Cup Carnival on it. And a loading screen too. And aside from that, it's the exact same game as World Cup Football from 1984. Possibly good for the time, but hopelessly outdated by 1986. Imagine, if you will, a situation where instead of FIFA 17, EA somehow releases, I don't know, FIFA 07 for the PS2 instead. That's kind of where we're at here. Arctic had done their part, but US Gold, well, they knew they had a complete duffel on their hands. World Cup Carnival was obviously a complete pile of shit, and they were going to be rightly scorched for trying to fob it off for their default price of a tenner per game. But what with spending the money for the license, getting Arctic to chuck something out and everything, they're in way too deep to cancel the game and write it off as a loss. They don't have that much money to spare. There is little that US Gold can do except to fill the box up with fluff. Inside the box you get so many different things, posters, fixture sheets for the World Cup, stickers, all sorts. It's all literally there to cover up a turd. Louis Taylor screamed at US Gold over the quality of the game, and US Gold, with no intention of saying what happened, had no choice but to shout right back and ride out the storm. And of course the reviews and reaction was just utterly savage all round, even more so from those who recognised that the game itself was ancient, had nothing to do with the World Cup, and had already been frickin' released a couple of years ago. The press universally scorched them. Of course, in the same month, a lot of the same press turned around and gave their star stickers, crash smashers and what have you to US Gold, who released the C64 and Spectrum versions of Access's classic leaderboard in the same month. This is the big example of US Gold overwhelming the shelves with volume and letting the market sort it out. Of course, the license itself still meant strong sales for World Cup Carnival, increasing the negative reaction even further. Of course, you've been seeing both the Speccy and C64 versions of the game while I'm talking, and I feel that I have to stress to you that nothing you're seeing was doctored or tampered with in any way. In all instances, I was playing a regular match against the computer, no hacks, no pokes, no nothing. In the Speccy version, you don't even get a net, which is frankly the least of the game's problems because most of the time when you're on the ball, there's a CPU player right on top of you, which means that both of you disappear. Simply running forward in a straight line is usually enough to get a chance at goal, mind you. In every version of the game, every other player on the pitch just stands there aside from the person who has the ball and the person who's fighting for it. So the C64 game, well, it did have nets, which is something they could lord over the Specky folks, but unfortunately this game is also horrendously broken. I've seen the CPU literally walk the ball along and then away from an open goal, several times in a match. There's also manual goalkeeping in this one, which you would have thought might help, but it's virtually impossible to save any ball that comes your way. I hesitate to say shot, as anything the computer does appears to be totally accidental. So, yeah. There's no need to even try and break anything here. This game comes broken right out of the box. Worst football game ever? Yes. Definitely. In fact, nothing else even comes close. Eventually, once the dust had settled, US Gold's excuse for the shocking quality of World Cup Carnival was that they had commissioned an anonymous programmer to write a game, but that game was terrible and there wasn't enough time to get a new game written before the Cup, so they went to Arctic. This is, of course, a load of bollocks. Said programmer and said game, a mythical, completed if not necessarily good World Cup Carnival, do not exist, despite rumours to the contrary. US Gold rode out the storm. The volume of titles they had coming out meant that in the end, they could afford to drop this colossal stinker, and even in the same month they were releasing other titles that were good or even great. The company that didn't ride the storm, however, was Arctic. The money gained from the deal with US Gold saved their bacon, but not for long. Because, in fact, the rights to World Cup football didn't belong to them anymore. They'd been sold some time before to Prism Leisure, who immediately demanded £25,000 in compensation. With no choice but to pay up, Arctic instantly lost all the money made from the US Gold deal. World Cup Carnival was their last act. The company went bankrupt almost immediately thereafter. Charles Cecil would eventually work for US Gold as their first head of development. World Cup Carnival certainly does go down as one of the most infamous releases in the history of the UK micros, and it is absolutely the worst thing US Gold ever released, that's quite obvious. Still, the general quality of their releases was high enough for them to ride it out. Indeed, they would retain the World Cup license in both 1990 and 1994, resulting in a couple more bad games, but at least they weren't ones that had already come out under another name. Of course, World Cup Carnival isn't something they intended to do right from the off. It wasn't malicious, just neglectful. US Gold's policy of flooding the market with their titles meant that it dropped off the radar for them, and Ocean weren't exactly unprolific themselves. It fell off for them too. It is something of a shame considering that we could have had a matchday-esque game if all had gone well. But US Gold and Ocean, despite their close relationship, was perhaps too big and too busy to work with each other in this way. The relationship kind of changes between them, ever slightly at this point, with both companies occupying the fields of licensed games and arcade conversions. What was a mutually beneficial friendship becomes more of a friendly and still beneficial rivalry, particularly for Woods and Ward thanks to their 50%. While both companies never snipe at each other, they certainly don't make plans for another World Cup Carnival again. By this time, US Gold are one of the most powerful software forces in the UK. They're still allied with Ocean, and in the mid-80s, Jeff Brown, through a sub-company, purchases 75% of shares in a then-struggling software house by the name of Gremlin Graphics. Gremlin's fortunes would soon change dramatically as they became one of the most critically successful houses of the second half of the decade, thus creating a triple alliance that likely makes US Gold the most dominant force in British gaming. If US Gold's success benefited Ocean, Gremlin's success benefited US Gold. Jeff Brown's empire then consisted of US Gold, Gremlin and Centresoft, with Ocean as allies. A bit more would be added to this. There was an advertising company called Camel handling the PR and developing a fine relationship with Newsfield, publishers of magazines like Crash and Zap 64. There was also a collaboration between Centresoft and Ocean that resulted in another label, the Hit Squad. This label, designed for budget re-releases of games, first made its mark with the They Sold a Million series of compilations of previous hits. Ocean and US Gold both had plenty to choose from, and they would add even more through purchasing the catalogue of games made by Ultimate Play the Game alongside that name, and also getting another label called Software Projects in on the act. And so, the first They Sold a Million compilation consisted of Ocean's Daily Thompson's Decathlon, US Gold's Beach-Head, Ultimate Saber Wolf, and software projects Jet Set Willy. The compilation itself would, indeed, sell a million, as would all the other entries in the series. So what are the management at US Gold like anyway? Truthfully, they're a bunch of pretty tough nuts. Jeff Brown is the charisma, the man up front, and he happily shows it. He makes a point of driving to meetings, any meetings, in his prized Ferrari Testarossa, but he does have a real keen eye for games that are eventually going to be successful. The manager Tim Chaney is the muscle. Tim made his original bones working at Jack Tramiel's Commodore, and he took lessons from the Don all too well, becoming a firm believer in the business's war psyche. Hired by the Browns for being the only person who managed to stiff them on a deal while he was still at Commodore, Chaney is a respected manager and a vicious attack dog to be set on retailers and press as and when needed. These qualities served US Gold very well when they tried to make something out of the shit that was World Cup Carnival. But Tim is nothing compared to the true muscle, Anne Brown, possibly the most feared woman in 1980s British gaming. Jeff is the face, Tim is the muscle, and Anne is the brains. Instrumental in the success of the company at every step, the force in all of the meetings, unfazed by everybody, and vengeful when anyone gets the drop on the company or even says a shitty word about them. Particularly Elite, who the Browns literally wanted to crush, never forgetting how they managed to snatch those Commando and Ghosts and Goblins licenses from them. They actively wondered why anyone even bothered to directly compete with them. The financial rewards were one thing, but US Gold really did care about being number one and having the best and most popular games. For now, they were right up there, despite the intensity of things and certain rivalries developing, Tim Chaney against Gremlins head Ian Stewart, for example, the ship was steady. Of course, the big thing was the special relationship, that one between US Gold and Ocean. With relations still cordial despite World Cup Carnival and both companies operating in the same space, they worked together in order to basically dominate the arcade conversion marketplace for themselves, with agreements on who handled what from what company. This is why, for example, you very rarely saw Ocean publish games by Sega or Capcom. These licenses were almost always done by US Gold. Likewise, Ocean would handle conversions of games by, say, Taito or Nintendo. You may look at a duffer of a conversion like, say, US Gold's Out one, and wonder if it would be better if Ocean had handled it, but it would have never happened because Ocean never put a bid in for such a license. And it worked. What with this, agreements also extending to release dates, and control in Centresoft, now easily the biggest distribution warehouse of games in the UK, the two companies dominated the arcade conversion market. Sure, the odd license may get snatched away here and there by Elite, Activision, or Grand Slam, but US Gold and Ocean were so much bigger that they weren't even really a threat to them. The only real issue was, as ever, how much Ocean benefited from US Gold's success, and they couldn't ever really get away from that. For US Gold, arcade conversions were now very much where the money was at. The original practice of importing games in from America, while successful, had a ceiling. That being the moment when the American companies thought that they didn't actually need to have US Gold acting as their middleman and just went ahead and started to do it all themselves. Microprose were the first to do this, severing their relationship with US Gold and establishing a UK branch in the late 80s. Oh, geez, covering US Gold can get quite tiring. There's just so many different entities to look at. Anyway, they did have quite a few developers who they would use on a regular basis for all of these arcade conversions and the like. With business going on as normal, let's have a look at some of them. This can also serve to wrap up the computer years of the company. It's time to start getting into the consoles. Probe Software were one of the bigger developers around in the late 80s, and they worked with plenty of people. You can find their name on games for Ocean, Infogrames, Virgin, all sorts, and they would be prolific in the 16-bit era too. They did several games for US Gold, all of which vary in quality somewhat. The best of their conversions is probably Solomon's Key, which as a puzzle game really works quite well on the computers. However, they did also do some quite duff ones. Probe's name was on the quite famously lackluster Out One port, and it was also on another quite badly reviewed port for Wygar, though this game does have its fans. However, it wasn't all bad. A couple of pretty great coders warned their staff, and they did some better games for another, more mysterious label in the US Gold Empire, one which we'll get to shortly. I should quickly mention Sinsoft, although we're kinda past them already. Sinsoft were US Gold's first extra label, and it wouldn't be their last. They only published games in 1984, and only four of them at that. Two of them are amongst US Gold's best releases, the fantastic isometric flying and bombing sim Blue Max, and an outstanding conversion of Sega's early arcade Smash Saxon. You also have Fort Apocalypse and Doughboy, a pair of kind of fun but decidedly hard shooters, of which Fort Apocalypse is the better one. Three of the four games were originally made by Synapse Studios in America, and Saxon was ported to the C64 by them, which is why Sinsoft is often regarded as merely an alternate name for said company, which isn't true, but presumably this label's creation was part of a partnership between the two companies that ended up being kinda short-lived. Tiatex were one of US Gold's biggest developers, and one that Jeff Brown himself had a stake in, so naturally a lot of work came their way. People have wondered why Tiatex got so much work with US Gold, and well, that's the obvious reason why. Anyway, they started making games for US Gold in 1986, and would continue to do so right up to the end. Their first few games are quite good actually, fine computer versions of both 720 Degrees and Rollin' Thunder to kick things off. Alas, these were followed up by an atrocious port of Street Fighter, and an even worse fighting game that was based off of their shitty port of Street Fighter, The Human Killing Machine. And so it would continue. Tiatex became infamous for largely very poor arcade ports, such as Strider, Thunderblade, and Road Blasters. Of course, seeing as how these guys would be US Gold's main developers in the 16-bit years, we're not done with them yet. What's also worthy of note is that of all these developers and labels, Tiatex are the only one that still exists today, as a developer of mobile and handheld games. We've looked briefly at Ocean's Hit Squad thanks to the Centresoft connection, but US Gold naturally had a budget reissue label all of their own, and that was, of course, Kix. Kix releases were typified by their trellis backgrounds and yellow text boxes that made them stand out almost as much as the Hit Squad's reissues. Kix didn't have quite as much software and agreements at their disposal as Hit Squad had early on. Short of US Gold re-releases, Kix largely re-released Gremlin games and a few others from the likes of, say, Palace Software. Still, that was plenty enough considering how vast US Gold's library was, and their library of other titles would increase over the years, resulting in the release of over 100 budget reissue titles on the label. Although Hit Squad is arguably the more famous budget label, Kix would outlast them and be used by US Gold right up to the end, and even a couple of years beyond that. Creative Materials were quite a short-lived company, only lasting for a couple of years. Mainly they're famous for the work of their star coder, a guy by the name of Richard Aplin. Aplin, through his work with Creative Materials and other companies, was famous for some strong work on arcade conversions. Such as, for example, managing to get the proper arcade sprites into Final Fight on the Amiga. Such things are a good example of his work, and represent Creative Materials at their best. And then of course there's eSWAT on the Spectrum, one that Aplin didn't work on, and is quite possibly the worst game we'll see in this whole video, and that's actually including World Cup Carnival. Another brief little thing, what's the deal with Jeff Brown's sub-company? The one that he used for his stake in Gremlin and possibly Tiatex 2? Well, there's nothing mysterious about it or even interesting really, but this company was formed in 1984 and called Woodward Brown Holdings after originally being called Firefast. There's not much at all to be said about this company to be honest until 1991 when the name is changed again to Center Gold Limited, but we'll come to that when we get there. Emerald Software were another short-lived company based out of Ireland, and in fact there's only one game that they're really famous for working with US Gold on, but it's a doozy, the computer version of Michael Jackson's Moonwalker. The Sega games based around this movie are rather strange in general, but the computer versions are, well, completely bats. This utterly obtuse top-down thing just doesn't work at all. US Gold were worried about the low quality of the game and it getting past Michael Jackson's lawyers, but eventually the game was accepted unseen and sold okay, despite reviews that could charitably be described as mixed. Several people from Emerald went on to long careers in the industry, including one Paul McLaughlin, who would move to the UK and establish a long working relationship with one Peter Molyneux, becoming head of art for Bullfrog, Lionhead and 22 Cans. I already covered Ultimate Play the Game in their own video, so this is basically just a recap. US Gold bought Ultimate from the Stamper Brothers in 1985 and continued to use the label. It's worth mentioning again as the games they released were all originals and constitute some of the few totally original non-licensed, non-conversion, non-import games that the company released around this time. Unfortunately, games like Martianoids, Bubbler, Cyber One and Pentagram were all utter crap and totally unworthy of the Ultimate name. My guess is that US Gold would have liked to use the label more as both an original games brand and a way to perhaps sneak some titles away from that Ocean agreement, but it never gathered much momentum and, to be honest, US Gold figured they were better off just re-releasing Ultimate's older, more successful games as budget titles. In any case, the Stamper's new company, Rare, bought back the Ultimate name and its catalogue in 1988. Software Creations did a couple of games for US Gold early on, mainly three Capcom conversions, all of which, unlike most of US Gold's Capcom conversions, were excellent. There's Bionic Commando for one. Sure, it's the much less liked arcade version, but it's a fully featured port, even on the Spectrum, and it has absolutely fantastic music. Then there's LED Storm, a somewhat obscure car shoot-em-up, but one that's worth playing, particularly on the Spectrum thanks to the absolutely ungodly music that makes the occasionally weak AY chip sound like the C64's SID chip. Even better is Ghouls and Ghosts, another full port for the computers, a total overachiever on the Spectrum, and again, fantastic music. There's a good reason for this. Software Creations mainly consisted of programmer Mike Follin and his brother, arguably the greatest video game music composer of all goddamn time, Tim Follin. You may know these guys better from NES games such as Silver Surfer and Solstice. For the most part, while their games vary wildly in quality, they're worth it just for the soundtracks alone. And finally, there's the mysterious case of Go. This isn't another developer. Go was a very short-lived label under the US Gold Empire. You can find the Go label mostly on conversions of Capcom games, usually on less famous games like the conversions of the aforementioned Bionic Commando, Black Tiger, Sidearms, and Tiger Road, among several others. Certainly not the most famous Capcom games, but the conversions are of varying and occasionally decent quality. A fair few of them were handled by either Probe or Software Creations, and honestly, they're usually better than the conversions of the more famous Capcom games. There's also the brilliantly animated Trantor, a game by David Perry, no, not that one, but the one also responsible for the likes of Savage and other games that really tested out the old micros, and who would later become very successful indeed. Go existed primarily as a way to get some games away from US Gold, and away from the 50% share that Ocean had in the company. However, it didn't take too long for Ward and Woods to twig on that the label was basically US Gold under a different name, and the threat of a lawsuit pretty much put the kibosh on Go for good. Most of the games were reissued by US Gold's primary budget label, Kix, or even, in the case of Trantor, virtually chucked away on magazine cover tapes. The label was briefly revived in 1993 and used for the Spectrum conversion of Street Fighter II The World Warrior. In a vain attempt to try and get in as many US Gold games as possible, I'm going to spend time going through a few of the more intriguing ones of the hundreds that they released. Of course, it's mostly arcade ports and the like, but there are some oddities. Also some other really good ones. And yes, some terrible ones. How's about a bit of the Blue Bomber to start us off? Yes, US Gold released a Mega Man game. Not on the Spectrum or anything like that, but on the Game Gear. This is an odd little thing from 1995 that's described as a hybrid between Mega Man's 4 and 5, and is not exactly well liked. Graphically, it looks fine enough to me, although people more familiar with the series than me can certainly point out inaccuracies, but it plays fine. However, the big problem with the game is that there are no continues, which considering the difficulty level of your typical Mega Man game, is pretty damn unfair. Anyone who is looking to assemble a complete US Gold collection for whatever ungodly reason, will find Mega Man to be the big stopgap. The game is valued at around £100 just for the cart alone, and nearly £400 complete, making it by far the most expensive Game Gear game, full stop. US Gold's take on Strider has been mentioned by me, hell, even reviewed, 4 years ago. Over here it's known as Strider 2, and in the US it's called Strider Returns. Either way, it has nothing to do with the later Capcom arcade game. This game, by Tiertex, is still an absolute stinker with the very worst Euro platformer traits, from randomly spawning enemies to endless leaps of faith and utter garbage design. It does have a bit where Strider, Hinjo, not Hiryu, not even Hien, turns into a robot, or at least it does on the home computer versions, which is where the Mega Drive game came from, but no matter what you choose to play this game on, it's horrendous. The best thing about the whole package is the Mega Drive version's insanely clear voice samples, which was kind of a rarity on the system.
I have you now.
And of course, we can't not mention US Gold's OutRun game on the Master System, the red-headed stepchild of Sega's driving franchise. OutRun Europa is just incredibly odd. I mean, the game puts you on a bike, and then in the second level, it puts you on a jet ski. There's some odd plot thing, you punch bikers out a la Road Rash, dodge the police, try to shoot down helicopters. The thing is, it's a perfectly decent game, but it's just not OutRun at all. Even before you add in the bike, it has nothing to do with the series. It smacks of being a different game entirely that the OutRun name was stuck on at the end in the belief it would sell better. This may well have happened, but people would have hardly expected something like this. But then Sega had already made what's essentially a Chase HQ clone called Battle OutRun before this game. There's still OutRun 2019 to come. So, this was just an odd chapter in the franchise's history. By the way, OutRun Europa is a Probe Software title, and if you can get past the name, then it's worth playing. Now, there may never be a bigger perceived difference of quality in a partnership than the one between US Gold and LucasArts, and it produced some strange fruit, mostly Star Wars based. Star Wars for the Game Gear is intriguing. It's a lot like the more famous NES game, but with its own quirks and quite a linear retelling of A New Hope that touches on most things in the movie, even down to a section at the start where you play as Princess Leia that I don't believe is in any other version. This game actually isn't all that bad either, especially not if you're used to the original game's eccentricities. Oh, and guess what? It's by Tiertex. Not a bad showing from them this time around, as it goes. Okay, this is one of the strangest games I have ever seen. Charlie Chaplin. And for a change, it's the DOS version. Released in 1988 by notoriously bad developers Canvas, it's best described as a slapstick simulator where you help Charlie film various scenes for his slapstick movies. This seems to consist entirely of going around and kicking things, oh, including this dog.
You'll kick my dog today,
you bastard fuck.
Sorry, had to. Anyway, you kick things, you avoid being hit, or do you? Isn't the little tramp supposed to be knocked on his ass? Wouldn't that make for a good scene? Who knows? This is one of those games where I have absolutely no idea on what to actually do, and I don't think anyone else who's played it has a clue either. One of the weirdest video games of the 1980s. Presumably sales were rubbish and mooted Buster Keaton or Harold Lloyd based sequels were scrapped. Sad, eh? I couldn't let this section go by without a mention of the Hurricanes, as it's quite an unlikely licensed game. What, don't you remember the Hurricanes? A very bad cartoon series based around the adventures of a football team that ran for a couple of years in the mid-90s, it somehow snagged itself a game. Published by US Gold and released for the Mega Drive in 1994, in Europe only. It's about the most generic licensed platformer you can find in most regards, with the only odd thing about it being that you attack with a football, using lethal passes and headshot lobs to beat your enemies into a bloody pulp. This is kind of fun, even if most of the game isn't. And hey, no matter what happens, your ball will always be replaced. Equally, I can't not throw in at least one more proper football game. As mentioned, US Gold kept the World Cup license even after the debacle that was World Cup Carnival. And one look at the game Tiertex chucked out for the 1994 World Cup will make you wish they hadn't. Holy crap, this is one stinker of a footy game, best described as a crippled version of Kickoff. Much like the tournament itself, This game is seemingly dedicated to nothing but making football seem like the most god-awful and unfun thing on the entire planet. Is it as bad as World Cup Carnival? Well, no, of course not. But it is pretty miserable regardless. Okay, one more game here. I had to look at this one just for the title. Killed Until Dead. Made by Artek and published by U.S. Gold for the Amstrad and Speccy, it's an adventure mystery type game where you have to stop one of five famous mystery writers from being killed to bits. Do you know the old 70s Neil Simon comedy, Murder by Death? This is basically a video game adaptation of said film, only without the official license. Seeing as it's an adventure game, I can't really say a whole lot about it in this brief capsule, although it seems half decent to me, but the title alone makes it worth a look. You may also want to listen to the classic Motorhead song Killed by Death while playing this game. You know, just for the kicks of it. As we enter the 90s, US Gold slowly undergo a period of transition. Tim Chaney leaves US Gold in 1989 purely because he wishes to do his own thing and ends up forming Tech Magic. Jeff and Dan Brown, while still working together professionally, ultimately divorce due to a total lack of work-life separation. The relationship between US Gold and Sega greatly improves, with US Gold ultimately agreeing to become the first European publisher of Master System games. And US Gold as a company have to seriously think about the increased cost of production for the cartridge games that are coming, both for the Mega Drive and Master System. The solution is preparing to float the company on the stock exchange, which means a consolidation of all that they own. Finally, the special relationship between US Gold and Ocean comes to an end, as US Gold buy back Warden Wood's shares in the company for £8 million. It's been a fruitful relationship and a powerful alliance, but US Gold gave Ocean far too much for what they offered in return, especially seeing as it wasn't that long before they didn't need Ocean's funding at all. While it was important in their infancy, now, well, it kinda represented a great deal of money lost. US Gold also free both Gremlin and Tiertex from their grasp, giving them options to buy back their stakes, which they do, although Tiertex will largely continue to work with the brand new form. Both companies will benefit greatly from what is to come. As we get further into the 16-bit age, US Gold finally make an overture to the States, opening up a win there. Most people across the pond won't have seen anything of US Gold at all until the 1990s come round, but they certainly make an impact when they do arrive. And all of this serves to increase the potential value the company has to prospective shareholders come flotation. Finally, Centresoft and US Gold are together, and they are now purchased, along with smaller companies under the empire, by what was Woodford Brown Holdings, which then becomes Centregold. Martin Savage, previously the financial director, rises to become one of the most powerful people in the company, ultimately becoming the new managing director. A value of £50 million is assigned to Centregold, with over 8 million shares up for grabs. And they sold like wildfire. There were over 100 million applications for shares from the city. US Gold were, in fact, the first computer games company to go public in the UK, and their arrival generated a lot of buzz, even if it also introduced even more pressure. And of course, going public made Jeff and Dan Brown millions of pounds. So in the early 90s, again, despite the reputation for poor games that they enjoy now, business for US Gold is still as good as ever. Being an important publisher for Master System games certainly bore fruit, as the system enjoyed a glorious long life in Europe that it didn't get anywhere else. They'd got a bit better with licenses, with the Olympics being probably their most successful one. Of course, back in the 80s, they'd been the UK distributor for all of Epic's Games games, all of which were greatly successful. And when Epic shut its doors in 1989, US Gold soldiered on, getting an official Summer and Winter Olympics license and giving the games to Tiertex. Olympic Gold for the Mega Drive is, to be honest, as good an athletics game as you'll find beyond the likes of the Track and Field series, and is full of button-mashy goodness. There was also the odd successful film license, such as Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade, another Tiertex title and, not exactly a good one, but a game that would sell bucket loads over several formats, making a few million pounds for US Gold. Critically average, but commercially a huge hit, and a very well-remembered Mega Drive title in Europe. And as far as critical and commercial hits go, well, it's easy to forget that US Gold published Flashback. Jeff Brown went to Delphine one day, saw the rotoscoping on a game they didn't have a name for yet, was utterly blown away and literally bought it Lennon Lear, the eventual result being one of the best games of the entire 16-bit era. And yeah, there's a few shite games too. Strider 2, otherwise known as Strider Returns, is quite simply abominable, either on the home computers or on the Mega Drive. We've covered this one before. The home computer version of Street Fighter 2 also goes down as a total stinker, a game that just didn't belong on the Amiga, let alone the C64 or Spectrum. The Godfather, a huge multi-disc game for the Amiga, was another license that totally missed the mark. It looks great, but that can't hide the bog-standard side-scroller that lies within. Still, US Gold had their hand in the release of so many games, either distributing a version here and there, re-releasing them on kicks, all sorts. It's tricky to sort it all out into good and bad. Over the course of 12 years, US Gold are credited on 346 individual titles on Moby Games. And that's not counting all the many different versions of said games. That's double the amount of games that Psygnosis were credited on in their lifetime. Stock Market Flotation was a huge success for US Gold, making the company an absolute ton of money, and also marking the first time that US Gold as a publishing arm's profit exceeded that of Centresoft. More games were thrown out there, from the utterly shocking likes of Winter Olympics Lilyhammer 94 and World Cup USA 94, to the quite good if brutally hard likes of The Incredible Hulk. In October of 1994, plans were made to expand further, with the acquisition of Core Design for around £5 million. Core at the time were a very well respected company with a lot of critical hits, but they weren't doing quite as well commercially. Still, Jeff Brown's eye is in pretty great shape. A lot of his decision to acquire Core was based on seeing the early prototypes on a certain game that one Toby Gard was heading up, involving a lady heroine's jumps and rolls around a bunch of ancient tombs. A bold move, to be sure. And then there was the formation of an in-house studio, Silicone Dreams, created in preparation for the 32-bit era to come. At this stage, all looked pretty damn great for US Gold. They were a huge force in European gaming, and they just got bigger and bigger. Dominant in the 8-bit era, they were right up at the top in the 16-bits too. They were now working with Nintendo as well, publishing games on the SNES without any effect to their Mega Drive interests. They had the publishing know-how, and they certainly had the distribution. Everything looked pretty good. And then things started to turn a little sour. The first hit came when LucasArts ended their working relationship with US Gold in 1994. Even more brutally, LucasArts switched allegiance to Virgin Interactive, who were at the time headed up by CEO Tim Cheney. The last game US Gold published for them was X-Wing, so that meant they missed out on quite a few really successful titles that were coming. It wasn't a critical hit to lose LucasArts, but it did kind of set a ball rolling. As Jeff Brown relates in the story of US Gold, they did rest on their laurels a bit at the time, resulting in the loss of LucasArts. If US Gold weren't a public company, this wouldn't have hurt as much. But losing LucasArts had a predictably bad effect on their stock. By this stage, buyers were also holding off on their stock to see what US Gold were going to do in the 32-bit market. It was kind of an awkward situation for Jeff Brown to be in, and one that he didn't particularly feel suited to. US Gold's final releases are mostly pretty simple affairs, neither bad nor good, and often made with Silicone Dreams. Their relationship with Axis did continue right to the end though, meaning that they published the Lynx series of golf games right up to the CD version of Lynx 386. There were other American imports of varying quality, games ranging from William Shatner's Tech War to Duke Nukem 3D. Not bad for being the second to last game the company would have a hand in. As far as more homegrown titles go, there were the last 16-bit games, things like Fever Pitch Soccer and Izzy's Quest for the Olympic Rings. In the end, US Gold were only involved in a handful of 32-bit titles, Johnny Bazooka Tone, Olympic Games Atlanta 1996, and Olympic Soccer. The final game that they would ever publish is actually one I'm kind of fond of, Olympic Summer Games for the Mega Drive, a fairly decent athletics game with kind of decent graphics for the system. Not quite as good as Olympic Gold, but not bad either. At this stage, things aren't exactly in freefall, but the ground is pretty shaky, and Jeff kind of feels that it's time to get out. He's not suited to being a CEO of a public company, and, well, hell, he's already a very rich man. There are people who want more and more and will work their ass off to get it, and some who, at a certain level, feel that enough's enough and don't want the intensity required to go even higher, that it's time to cash in those chips and return to normality. Jeff Brown is obviously the latter. A big buyer would soon come his way, in the form of Eidos Interactive. Eidos had started out in 1990 as a video compression company, and they would become one of the biggest UK games companies around. But they didn't even start in games at all until 1995, when Eidos Interactive was formed and the company bought Domark. And then, in 1996, they would buy Centregold for approximately £18 million. The whole lot, including the U.S. Gold label, Centresoft, Silicon Dreams, and Core Design. Jeff had absolutely no regrets whatsoever. By the end, he was quite happy to cash in. But he wasn't done yet. There is a good epilogue. Jeff Brown became Eidos' worldwide publishing director and immediately started convincing Eidos to get fully behind the game that Core were working on, the one that had convinced him to buy Core Design, Tomb Raider. They did, and that turned out pretty well. Millions upon millions of copies sold, the PlayStation superstar, and so forth. It was good work. It established Eidos as one of the biggest games companies in Europe virtually on its own, and it was Jeff Brown's final major bow in the industry. He resigned his post at Eidos not long thereafter, not happy with such a big corporate role. Eidos dropped the US Gold label for good, and ended up selling Centresoft to Activision in 1997, where it remains to this day. Still the biggest distribution centre of video games and accessories in the country. So it's certainly a good ending. We're kind of used to seeing lengthy falls, a long period where the company just gradually loses relevance, ends up becoming a shell of its former self and so forth. In the case of US Gold, they saw that the winds were changing and got out while the going was still okay, making a ton of cash. Jeff Brown did very well out of the games industry, very well indeed, as did Anne. And Jeff still does. Now based in the States, he's taken little roles here and there in management for various game studios, the sort of stuff that he's happy doing, and he's still playing music. How to sum up US Gold, then? I think most people would have expected me to do a lot more bashing of the company than I have done, because yes, they are certainly notorious for the odd bad game here and there, and there is the perception today that almost all of their games were of poor quality, largely thanks to the Capcom arcade conversions. But, well, no. US Gold as a whole were not a bad company. There's obviously some isolated incidents that deserve attention, but that doesn't represent their whole output. They were instrumental in getting a lot, and I really do mean a lot, of good games over here to the UK. Jeff Brown, a guy who I can't help but like, had a great eye for games that were going to be really good and successful. He showed that with Flashback and Tomb Raider. It's difficult. US Gold are almost purely a publisher, not a hybrid in the way that Ocean or Psygnosis were. And being a publisher and distributor is usually a thankless task, one where you're only really noticed by people like me if you're releasing a lot of shite. And they did, primarily because they released a lot of games. You certainly can't fault them on quantity, but they reasoned that the market would decide what was good and what wasn't, and the good would sell. And usually they were right to do that. In the end, there was a great drive to be successful, to be at the top of the charts both critically and commercially. And well, they did succeed. And unlike a lot of the companies we've covered, they got out while the sun was still shining. So I'm sorry to disappoint folks, but if you want a brilliant example of a highly successful British games company, one that generally kept up a decent standard of releases and didn't end up devouring itself, look no further than US Gold, one of the most dominant software forces in Europe, and one where I can truly say that the impact of what they did is still being felt in the industry to this day. Bye for now. I'd like to throw a very special thanks to Chris Wilkins for his amazing book, The Story of U.S. Gold, a book that was absolutely essential to the creation of this video and one that is highly recommended. A link to buy it is in the description below. Do please go and do so. Thank you so much also for watching this video on the story of U.S. Gold. If you liked the video, then do please like it, subscribe to the channel, follow me on social media, or indeed support me on Patreon. And as usual, we have Lee Patreons to thank. Seth Robinson, Jason Leach, Sean Zoltek, Ian Roberts, Graven Blackpool, Ben Coker, Martin Pataki, Taylor Armand, Mark Johnston, Twisted Squote, Mitchell Mann, Simon Gulliver, Andy Capped, Andrew Dalton, Johan Eriksson, David Page, Conformist, Jake Elwich, El O'Brien, Keith Barlow, Peter Sidorn, Grant Butler, Bichardi, Thiago Pereira dos Santos Silva, Olaf Albin, Dragon Sex Master, Joel Hartman, Phil Taprock, Jamie Hampshire, Romeo, Lee Norris, Tim Lintz, Robert Kelly, Matt Lee, Jamie Davenport, Simon Oile, The Chief Lunatic, Dennis Andre, Lotaro Oino, Chris, Mark Brinton, Jan Mahust, Craig Nellist, James Malloy, John Davenport, Olaf Jonsson, James Halliday, Richard Bearwell, Hagenator, Waddick, Ken Barraclough, Alvaro Gonzalez, Stephen Hornsby, Jan Best, Robin Banks, Dan Wasco, Christian Earnshaw, Kev Gilmore, Alexander Green, Greg Olson, Mark Johnson, Stuart Ashen, James Idd, Novel, Gerard Morris, Mike Siegler, Mark Brooks, Jan Velton, Gianni Giacchetta, Thomas Daniels, Lee Harris, Russell Hugo, Paolo Leary, Graham Kamak, Scott Mittin, Nicole Ketchum, and the Ninth Demon. Thank you all so much for your continued love and support. Next time we'll be having a little bit of a lighter video on another classic Spectrum game, and then after that some magazine stuff's coming, so do look forward to that. But until then, as ever I shall say, wherever you are and whoever you be, have a good one, take care, and I'll see you next time. Bye for now!